Hello, hello, hello. Good morning, all. A beautiful day today. You. Sadly, probably not. But, one point.
Man.
My favorite. Russel Brand. They're already going live now. Going over Crank. I'm liking his name. Donald Trump. Donald Trump's response. So we'll go ahead and dive right in.
...of the narrative to almost cartoon proportions to prevent the naturally emerging truth from bubbling up. Let me just read...
I didn't even have my mic.
Please.
Jesus.
The opposition to the NATO, CIA, EU position... on the war in Ukraine makes you a far-right fascist is one of the most laughably stupid narrative fairy tales yet disseminated. Much of the international left shares Lula's views on the war because there, the left isn't Bernie, AOC. So I guess it shows how the taxonomies around this discourse are continually shifting.
Yeah, yeah, it's inconvenient, isn't it, that Lula, supposedly an extremely left-wing person, is now saying... I don't go along with this war.
It's also inconvenient that he's called Lula and that's too much like either a dog or pop star name rather than a presidential handle. Another story we want to talk to you about, but if you're watching this on YouTube, stay with us because after we click over to being exclusively on Rumble, we're going to be looking at that Pfizer sting in more detail and in particular why the mainstream media not reporting on this story is evidently having an impact along with some other policy changes internationally.
I need to prepare for that.
Pfizer's share price is dropping. Even if you don't agree with the methods that that sting entailed, you have to acknowledge it's a story worth reporting on. There's a sort of a share drop there. Not that I'm a person that really understands things like that, Gal.
No.
I don't understand what a downward sort of...
You'd think that means things are getting worse for Pfizer.
Not that I'm a person that really understands things like that, Gal.
No.
I don't understand what a downward sort of...
You'd think that means things are getting worse for Pfizer.
That sort of that bit of... that there. The only time you want to see a slope like that is when he's skiing on it. With money that...
Klaus,
the baller, he's looking at that there. The only time he wants to see a slope like that is when he's skiing on it. With money that...
With Klaus.
Mate, the other thing I want to look at now is...
With money that...
With Klaus. Him and Klaus skiing along with money paid for with your taxpayer dollars. Mate, the other thing I want to look at now is... We talk a lot about... ...with Jeffrey Epstein was a significant one. I think when Kim Iverson came on, she said that this is an amazing thing, that Bill Gates doesn't... Or through the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation doesn't only fund the WHO, he funds other organisations that also fund the WHO. So the idea that we have of the WHO, its name sounds so sort of anodyne, bureaucratic and neutral. Well, ultimately, it could be the plaything of one incredibly powerful individual. It's difficult to imagine that you could work at the WHO and be influential in policy and be really sort of steeply at odds with Bill Gates, isn't it? You sort of almost necessarily have to carry some of his perspectives. Now, some of the things we're going to say about Bill Gates... and Bill Gates' vaccine timeline might get us into some contentious... ...to carry some of his perspectives. Now, some of the things we're going to say about Bill Gates and Bill Gates' vaccine timeline might get us into some contentious positions on YouTube. So if we suddenly stop broadcasting on YouTube, you know that is why we're doing it. Simply join us over on Rumble, where we can speak freely... ultimately about how power operates, how we're continually divided, how dissenting voices are smeared and condemned, how democracy is essentially a charade now, how centralized, privately funded bodies are able to dictate global policy when it comes to censorship and that where your taxpayer money is going. And we want to talk about not the conspiratorial aspect of Bill Gates and some of his relationships. We want to talk particularly about Bill Gates as an investor and Bill Gates as an influencer. I don't mean in a TikTok way. I don't mean...
Although he did do that TikTok on corn.
With a corn on the cob.
Yeah.
Actually, he was quite good at that.
That's pretty good, wasn't
Still
it?
Said that
what I
audio.
Resent about Bill Gates is in presenting himself as a sort of a kind of neutral, benign, well-meaning nerd. When potentially...
Got it.
He's a kind of nefarious figure pulling the strings of global organizations and dabbling in areas where he has no expertise, where like, or hasn't, like medicine and agriculture in particular are two areas where I think Bill Gates has undue influence. And
there was this, that big pushback, wasn't there, from African farmers, like a group of, I think, 50 African organizations saying that the methods that Bill Gates was pushing were really
precisely
good.
The things that are nausing up our farms in these various African nations. Yeah, there was. And like Vandana Shiva, friend of our show, talks about the negative impact of Bill Gates on Indian agriculture, him being in fact the inheritor of Monsanto's mantle as globalist dabbler in Indian affairs, and you know, primarily for ill. If you're still watching this on YouTube, we're going to click off in a second. Jimmy Dore's joining us in a minute, and we're going to be talking about the Pfizer sting and showing some footage from that. And now we're going to do the Bill Gates vaccine timeline. What did Bill Gates say on a Monday? What does he say on a Tuesday? How have Bill Gates' views on vaccines evolved throughout the pandemic period? And how are his investments a timely indication of potential other objectives? Other than, of course, what we all know is that Bill Gates is the world's number one philanthropist. But there, perhaps there's another story. We're going to leave you guys on YouTube now. Join us over on Rumble where we can speak freely and be ourselves and take our tops off. See you in a moment. Okay, let's look at this. I love this that you've created here. This is 2011. Back in 2011, Bill Gates says that vaccine investment offers the best returns, according to a report from Reuters. Vaccines are one of the best investments we can make in the future. So at that point, Bill Gates is looking at vaccines just from a financial perspective, not from a moral, ethical, or humanitarian perspective. Is that right? Is that
correct?
Fair to say?
I saw.
Because you created this document.
I did, yeah.
Mostly I do all this work myself.
I know,
as you know. Lighting all right? I did it earlier myself.
I borrowed some techniques from you.
You plagiarized my methods. September 2019, this is sort of before, like some people that we've had even on this show are saying, oh, the pandemic was around before then. And we've had people on there. Some people get so complex around this stuff, Gal, like you can't carry all of the narratives. That's why one of the things that I think we can offer the world is even when we're talking about tyrannical figures who draw global disdain because of their undue power, we can still build academic and demonstrable arguments, i.e. you don't have to lean into all of this sort of Epstein stuff, even though there seems like there's some evidence that his relationship with Epstein involved the setting up of his foundation and the Clintons' relationship with Epstein, super interesting.
I think apparently it was a lot connected to the fact that Bill Gates wanted a Nobel Peace Prize.
You there, sir, put her down and tell me how to get a Nobel. Why would you turn to Jeffrey Epstein?
I know.
For a Nobel Peace Prize.
And at that point, we are off YouTube.
We're off now.
Pretty sure Epstein already was a registered convicted sex offender at that point.
Sir, you know a lot about sex offences. I certainly do. How can I help you? I want a Nobel Peace Prize. That's not what we're doing on that island. It's not so much about Nobel, but the first syllable we can help you with.
Very nice.
Thank you. 2019, September, Bill Gates initially invests $55 million on a pre-IPO equity investment into BioNTech. Gates' investment in BioNTech may be higher than that. It's reported that the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation chose to allocate 33.68% of its assets to the company, approximately 1 million shares. So in 2019, they heavily invested in BioNTech. At that point, BioNTech haven't come up with an mRNA vaccine. Are they one of the mRNA ones? They're the ones that Pfizer required,
no, that's right.
Right?
Yeah. They are. Them and Moderna are the mRNA guys.
They're the dons of mRNA.
Yep.
Although Robert Malone, a man who's continually urged caution around mRNAs, and he claims to have invented them, he was one of the people who was like, hang on a minute, we might be getting carried away here, wasn't
he? Yeah, he was.
That was his sort of his position.
People didn't like that.
Be a bit more enthusiastic about your inventions, mate. This is your time to shine. This is your moment. January 2020, a Washington State resident becomes the first person in the United States with a confirmed case of the 2019 novel coronavirus. January 2021, Gates says, everyone who takes the vaccine is not just protecting themselves, but reducing their transmission to other people and allowing society to get back to normal. Now, that's one of the bits that we have to be careful of on YouTube, because guess whose guidelines YouTube use to dictate what you can say about vaccines on YouTube? It's the WHO. Guess who funds the WHO significantly? The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and some of the other contributors to the WHO are also funded by Bill and Melinda Gates. So this is not the area of conspiracy theory right now. This is just blunt, brutal economics.
Isn't she wants her name taken out of it now?
Yeah, I do. I read Melinda Gates is like, listen, because Melinda Gates, like it said on that sort of rather amusing Australian TV show, Melinda Gates was not happy about
she
it
was
being
not.
No one wants their husband hanging out of Epstein.
No.
If at
you,
best.
If you say, I've got a new mate, oh, by the
who
way,
is it?
It's a registered sex offender.
He's been registered as that. Well, at least is he trying to get help? Like, is that being on the register?
To be, no.
The
sex offender's
register. I don't
think that's what he's doing
on Jeffrey Dahmer, here. Epstein, where are you, Epstein? Did you take your shoelaces out? No, we didn't bother. I hope those cameras are working. Some of my jokes about Epstein. We're on rubble. So, sorry, mate, what was you saying? You were just doing a joke about that. Like, if Jeffrey Epstein comes over and is your mate, he's at best like one of them friends who always wants to take you out to sleazy dives.
Yes.
At best. Yeah. At worst, he's flying
you
around
I
the
think
world.
You learn through sex experience not to go with him anymore on those little trips.
This flight is in one way free and in another way quite costly. Mm. So where are we up to, mate?
We're up to 2021.
Oh, yeah, January 2021. Gates describes the mRNA vaccines as magic. So he said they stopped transmission. He's described them as magic when we now know that they've never tested them for transition, and they're not really magic, unless by magic you mean the ability to stop the heart of a 25-year-old man in his prime. I don't know that that's been proven. Some of that excess death stuff, it's not nailed down. And some of the sudden death syndrome, where do we stand on that?
No.
We're waiting for some more science on that.
What happens?
Hopefully some of those big pharmaceutical companies, they'll be chomping at the bit to carry out studies.
They are currently investigating. Yeah.
Who's investigating it?
These companies, Pfizer, etc., the FDA, they are investigating whether or not myocarditis and risk of strokes can be associated with the vaccine.
Eek.
So, and that's officially, that's, you know, CDC.
That's all you can say.
That's absolutely all you can say. Yeah.
Yeah, that's all you can say about the excess deaths and all that stuff. And it's best to be a bit sober on these topics.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, I think so. I mean,
what's the point in being hysterical and crazy?
I don't think we should be.
Just a bit of fun. But don't, because these are actually quite serious subjects, and we're trying to organise, curate a sensible response to what appears to potentially be, if not corruption, colossal ineptitude. Was that a bit more sober?
Yeah, it was really good.
Thanks, mate. I'll just finish this, and then we've got our Here's the News Today, sort of our take on the Pfizer sting story, but we'll just finish this thing about Bill Gates, can we? Because I'm into it.
You're in charge.
Yeah, I'm in charge, aren't I? Yeah, but we're a team.
Yep.
Democracy.
Yep.
You know I'm into that. Gates says in an interview in April 21 that US and developed countries shouldn't lift COVID-19 vaccine patent protection, which you've always not liked, Gal, have you?
Well, no. I mean, if you're going to say we want these vaccines are there to protect us all and to essentially rid us of coronavirus and get us through this pandemic, and then you're saying we're not going to share them with the world, basically. I mean, that literally
is greedy
and totally hypocritical. Yeah.
Although I've seen him say it, he goes, it's not a simple business. You don't just let anyone just make these vaccines.
No.
They're complicated.
Yeah, but that's the little suggestion there. And I think he said the same with African farming compared
to racist?
Kumbaya techniques of farming that he spoke about. And in a little way,
it's a little bit of a
kind of saying the same thing that people in underdeveloped nations, they don't have the ability to
do these
vaccines.
They won't understand a vaccine or like that. Like Vandana Shiva says, like, he's a proper colonialist.
Yeah.
Like, and that's a colonial attitude. Certainly, whether or not it's the people in African nations or the world of Indian agriculture, the whole point of globalism is built on aristocratic principles of we, a cadre of experts, know better than you, and we ain't got time to explain to you why. So what we're going to do is we're going to invest heavily in media and make sure we've got alliances in media
that
only one side of the story will ever be promoted, even though other stories will emerge, as this Pfizer sting deal demonstrates. But look, what I reckon this Bill Gates timeline demonstrates, and we can't spend any more time in it because we've got Jimmy Dore coming up later, and we've got a fantastic presentation on
basically,
the Pfizer
sting. He made a lot of money. He 10 times his money he made, then he sold some of his stock, and now he's saying the vaccines don't work very well.
Try and wrap it up like a Christmas cracker joke. It's $550 million he made out of BioNTech after a $55 million. Where does that go? Does that go back into this? Because Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, they're selling themselves like they're Oxfam. That all they're doing is helping people.
The non-profit.
Like, it's a little oboe. That's what they're trying to tell. Like, well, we just go around. There's a voice. Keeps on calling me. Mm. Investing in vaccines. That's where I'll always be. In 2022, Gates sells some of his BioNTech stock, representing a huge gain for him over when he invested. That was in 2022. Good timing. January 2023, Gates tells the Lowy Institute think tank in Sydney that current vaccines are not infection blocking. They're not broad. So when new variants come up, you lose protection. They're very short duration. So once he flocked the stuff, once he sold his share, then vaccines were crap. Wouldn't he?
Yeah, I mean, it does seem like that. Either that's a way of, you know, being, I guess, truthful about the situation now he doesn't own stocks in them, or he's saying we need to keep developing them.
Yeah. I'm invested in now.
And we know that they're looking at annual shots.
All you need to know, if, like, you want to make money in this crazy world, is what is Nancy Pelosi investing in, and what's Bill Gates investing in? Invest in that, and you'll be right as rain, although the old soul might struggle, is what I would say. Now, you know we do these presentations, here's the news, no, here's the effing news. Today, we're looking at the mainstream media's neglect of Project Veritas's sting operation on that Pfizer executive. After we've watched it, we're going to look in detail at some of the footage. It's sort of a bit heartbreaking. It's watching that guy in that restaurant flapping around like when a bird gets in your house and goes all up the windows and poos all over your patio doors. But this bit,
that guy really got caught slipping for sure.
Looking at some of the content, some of the revelations, the revolving door between Pfizer and the FDA. This has been watched 50 million times on Twitter. If Musk weren't there, you can bet your ass it would have been pulled off that. What do you think? Let me know in the comments in the chat. If it weren't for Musk, do you think that would be up on Twitter? It's been removed from from YouTube, and it's been removed even from the newspapers dare to report on it. Have a little look, stay with us. Remember to let us know what you think of it in the chat and the comments. Here's the news. No, here's the effing news.
Here's the fucking news.
While the mainstream media refuse to acknowledge it, the stock market don't lie. And Pfizer's stock price plummeted after a story broke that you know about and I know about, but the mainstream media won't discuss.
Why? Because they have a thing about.
We live in a climate now where a story that ought to be everywhere is being suppressed. I'm of course referring to Project Veritas's sting operation on a Pfizer employee, allegedly, in which he revealed all sorts of interesting practices that are allegedly taking place within Pfizer, many of which confirm things that we've fought for a long time. You'll have seen it covered elsewhere online, but why are the mainstream media unwilling to touch it? And if it's not true, why has the stock market responded in the way that it has? And it's weird, isn't it? Because the mainstream media, they're there to tell us information, right? But they're not telling us this information. Could it be for this reason? No, it can't be anything to do with that. I'm paranoid. I'm a conspiracy theorist. Where's my tinfoil hat? After a record year, because for some reason, Pfizer made a lot of money in the last couple of years. Drug maker Pfizer stock is down 14% this month, primarily on concern about the likely sales declines for its two COVID blockbusters, the Comirnaty vaccine and the Paxlovid retroviral treatment. 14% is a significant sum of money when you consider that they earned $100 billion last year. So it's hardly a surprise that this video is usually banned on YouTube and you cannot find it using Google. That in itself suggests further affiliations. Were it not for the fact that Elon Musk owns Twitter, you wouldn't be able to watch this video anywhere except for our home, Rumble. Pfizer said in a statement on Friday they have not conducted gain of function or directed evolution research during their COVID-19 research after a viral video posted on Thursday by Project Veritas, a non-profit group, showed an apparent Pfizer executive saying the company had done so. Now, this clip can only really be seen on Twitter, and you know that if Elon Musk hadn't taken over Twitter, you wouldn't be able to see it there either. That's why, I suppose, there was so much establishment, sturm, drang, consternation, and outrage about Musk's purchase of that platform. It seems that they want absolute control of this narrative in particular. I think the pandemic has provided us with a lens, an ability to see how power operates, to see that in a world where information is so readily accessible, where communication is so immediate, the necessity to control dissent, to censor, to smear people that are outside of the narrative becomes of optimum value. This evolving story shows us that you can't stop the truth getting out. So you have to smear the truth. You have to continually manage it. I mean, aren't you now, at this point, starting to recognize how the machinery works? Isn't it like the skin has been peeled away and you can see the sinew and muscular and skeletal function of establishment machinery? machinery. It's becoming more and more obvious the more this story evolves. Let me know in the chat, let me know in the comments what you think. The video lasts almost 10 minutes, a large part of which showed a person talking about internal operations at Pfizer. It's really funny, you gotta watch this thing. Apparently it's the third date between the guy in question that works at Pfizer and the person that was dating him. Date one, we're talking about like, what's your favorite show? I don't know, I like Wicked, I like Book of Mormon. Yeah, second date, what's your favorite fizzy drink? I don't know, I like Pepsi Cola. Yeah, the Washington Post said, would you tell me now, is your company involved in gain of function research? And when the guy's confronted at the end by Project Veritas, it looks like when you've got a bird trapped in your house. He's just flapping around, wrapped up in the curtains, pooing all over stuff. He goes mental in there. And I actually felt a little bit sorry for him at that point. And he, as a human being, of course, is, warrants respect and dignity and all of that. This is only of interest to me for a few reasons. Much of the stuff we've been talking about for ages appears to be, on the basis of this interview, a little more verifiable. And also, why aren't the mainstream media talking about it? Why are they not talking about it? The Hunter Biden thing held back. This story held back. This is censorship on an enormous scale. And censorship is a symptom of paternalism. It means we're regarded as children. Really, we're not able to make our own decisions. We're not allowed to be wrong.
I'm not going to go through all of this. But I'm going to play a little bit of this. And then I'm going to add some of my reactions and commentary. So we'll jump around a little bit. Let's go ahead and play some of it.
About mutating COVID?
Well, that's not what
we versus centralized power. We have all got more in common with one another than we have with the establishment at this point. The person also said that COVID-19 is the company's cash cow, adding that the company is trying to mutate the novel coronavirus. The video has attracted more than 45 million views on Twitter. According to Project Veritas, the person is Jordan Tristan Walker, Pfizer Director of Research and Development, Strategic Operations, mRNA Scientific Planner. We can't independently confirm the person's identity at the time of this recording. Pfizer didn't admit or deny if Walker is an employee. They didn't mention the video in their announcement either. But James O'Keefe, head of Project Veritas, posted photos and screenshots of what he claimed to be internal Pfizer documents showing Walker's position in the company. If what the person said in the videos is true, some people say it would be a public relations disaster for Pfizer, as many readers will perceive the content as that Pfizer is making new COVID-19 variants in order to sell more vaccines and medicine. That's being alleged elsewhere, I'm not saying that. They see James O'Keefe in action, confronting this supposed Pfizer employee.
Hey there, is this seat taken? You work for Pfizer. My question for you is, why does Pfizer want to hide from the public the fact that they're mutating the COVID virus?
Is this real life? I'm literally a liar.
Is this real life? Seems like it's real life. Yeah, it becomes an amazing video. I'm not sure how much we're allowed to show, but my favorite moments from the video, though I feel some sympathy actually for the man, because he sort of seems trapped, like I said, like a bird or like a dog in a schoolyard, just chaotic and like he shouldn't be there. What I enjoy is the way that he had to go from being on a date, well, hello, darling, how's things going, to being like, oh no! And him as a person is not really the center of this story. It's just an extraordinary dynamic that in the end it's human frailty that reveals stuff that many of us have long suspected, and that to me doesn't look like a person who's completely at ease and relaxed. It could be this. Yeah, I work at Pfizer. Yeah, of course, we're just doing our best to make medicines that help people. People were getting tattoos of Pfizer. They were in jackets of Pfizer. They were singing songs. They were turning it into like an international course. But I think at this point we're starting to see what's been really going on.
I was trying to impress a person on a date.
Instead of saying I'm like a really good driver, I'm good at fighting, I'm incredibly tall, I'm the world's best basketballer. Instead of that, do you know what's going on? We're working on gain-of-function research, as a matter of fact. Allegedly. Sure, maybe it did come from a lab. Oh my God, you're gorgeous. Take your top off.
Please, this is absurd.
Don't touch me. Well, this is not, by the way,
why are you doing this?
Tell anybody.
Someone who's just working at a company to literally help the public.
That's right, just old Pfizer there, literally helping the public, just to help them have their most profitable year in history.
You really did. Please bring the cops as soon as possible. It's very unsafe.
Can you please unlock your door? No, don't let them leave.
Then it's like a really amazing bit where he locks the restaurant and calls the police.
I did not hear any of this part. That's crazy.
Technically. So on top of all of these peculiar allegations about what's been going on in Pfizer, he individually kidnapped someone. Allegedly. James O'Keefe, here he is. He's escaped from the restaurant now.
You just witnessed one of the most remarkable interactions ever. Do we have the iPad? So we're getting into the vehicle now. Where's our car?
Stop. I mean, that's also not normal behaviour, to be jumping in front of a car. A lot of the mainstream media apparently won't report this because they say that Veritas is like a right-wing source.
This guy is scared.
Right-wing, left-wing. I think at this point in the argument, it's starting to become clear that there is a centralised narrative around numerous subjects, and there are peripheral critiques that are prevented from being proliferated because they are essentially dissenting voices. And as time goes on, around this subject in particular, aren't you now starting to recognise that the information we were given at the beginning of this pandemic, particularly with the vaccine rollout, is questionable in many ways? And for a while, it wasn't questionable. You literally couldn't ask questions. And that is not democratic. At this point, the categories of left and right are irrelevant. We are in the category now of right and wrong. We don't care what your political affiliations are anymore. We don't care if you're criticising Big Pharma and Pfizer in particular because of the profiteering, the stock manipulation, the previous out-of-court settlements and payouts, or because you've got doubts about the way that this vaccine was presented and the subsequent information around excess debt and adverse information is presented. It doesn't matter anymore. You still have the same enemy. And that, I believe, is a perfect example. That's why we talk about this subject so much. Not because I'm particularly obsessed or care about what medications you take or don't take. I don't care. My particular perspective is I'm mistrustful of government and I'm mistrustful of centralized corporate power and I'm doubly distrusting of where those interests converge to create some sort of super Ghostbusters stream where the media get involved. You can't even talk about it. That's what interests me. That is what should interest you. Left and right, those terms are dead to me now. Right and wrong are the terms that we need to use. And a new political inclusive movement has to emerge from this because we don't have any voices. What interests us is not the efficacy necessarily of particular products. What interests us is the efficacy of media reporting, is the efficacy of democracy, is the efficacy of the morality that these people claim when they are pushing these products. We've got to help one another. We've got to do what's best for everybody. Well, under those circumstances, how can we have such profiteering? How can we have such extensive censorship? Why are the mainstream media not reporting on this? Why were patents not afforded to poorer countries? There are so many unanswered questions. And the reason that there are unanswered questions is you can't answer those questions without disrupting the interests of the powerful. And it is precisely our job as an independent news organization, an independent social movement, to disrupt those interests, to ask those questions. And we wouldn't be able to do it without you. So whether you're left or right, it doesn't matter anymore. Question the integrity of the intentions of the powerful and open your hearts to one another. Otherwise, we are doomed to atrophy under centralized and undemocratic power with a media that will do nothing to protect us and ask the necessary questions. But that's just what I think. Let me know what you think in the chat and the comments. I'll be reading those comments in a moment.
Thank you for choosing Fox. Here's the fucking news.
Who was that confident young man in all those necklaces? Enjoy him. A lot of you excited to see Jimmy Dore. Jimmy Dore's coming up in a minute. And a lot of you are interested in this Pfizer sting Operation Cocktail. I still want to know if the Veritas reporter had to take one for the team. It was the third day. That is the thing that's pretty interesting about this. As part of the sting, as I understand it, is that they've been honey trapping him. It's called a honey trap.
That's right.
Honey trap techniques, I think, were pioneered by British intelligence to trap Republican freedom fighters in the nation of Ireland era during the 70s and 80s. In this version of the honey trap, Project Veritas have sent out a geezer on a date with, is he called Josh? That lad, or Justin, is a J word, wasn't it? Jordan Tristan Walker. He's done date one. I wonder how that went. I wonder what the conversation
pretty
went.
Well.
And then date two, that's gone well. What if they fell in love? That's what I like to think.
Yeah.
Do you think the relationship stands a chance after this? Probably not.
No, I wouldn't say so.
After you've done a sting, you can't then go, oh, look, all the Pfizer stuff aside, I actually quite like you. All of the revelations about gain-of-function research or some variation of that hidden behind bureaucratic jargon, behind the argot of Big Pharma, I still like you.
Yeah.
Aside from the revolving door, people leaving Pfizer and working for the FDA, I felt we had something. Mm. Do you think you could do a honey trap?
No, I don't think so.
You wouldn't be able to hold it together?
No.
I mean, a normal date is quite stressful. So yeah. If you know you're also doing a honey trap, you're wearing a freaking wire, man.
Yeah, I worry what people are just going to think of how I look, let alone, you know...
you're handsome.
Well,
people
might
not
think
you're out
that.
There honey trapping, you're wearing a wire, you're trying to lure someone into a trap.
Mm.
Oh, like, what? Well, also, it's really funny the way that the geezer's asking there. So what do you think about gain-of-function research? It's sort of like, I think that they're sort of quite abrupt, a lot of the questions
they
that
are.
He's asking.
Too abrupt. But maybe after three dates, you know. Who knows anything. What happened on the first two dates? It could
in
have
our
been
country,
very
England,
romantic.
And in America, third date, that's yeah. generally it's accepted that we're moving towards let's get physical, mm. aren't we?
Yep.
In the words of Sheena Easton. So.
Good reference.
Should we have a look at a bit of Jordan Tristan Walker? Bless him. I feel sorry for him at the end of it.
He's in the single heartbeat.
Because he was thinking, oh yes, I'm about to get fucked, and turns out he was. Mm. Let's have a look at this now.
They're not about to be recording me. Oh my god, Jason, that'd be horrible. You better not be recording me or something.
Is this seat taken?
What?
Hi.
It's weird, isn't it? Because we're used to the grammar of this now from things like sort of TV shows
yeah.
where they do stuff like that.
Yeah.
What about that one that's on YouTube, Catch a Nonce, or whatever it's called?
Is it?
Like, it's called Pedo Catcher
oh, wow.
or something like that. The guy, like, they sort of set up stuff for pedos, and then, like, the pedo is about to go to the date, and then it turns out he's going to fly you to his island, but unfortunately, last minute, he's hung himself. No, it's like, it's called Catch a Nonce or something like
right.
that.
Right. Great title.
Yeah.
Not like, sure it'll make it onto CNN
you
or.
You can't have Catch a Nonce on CNN. There's a lot of problems because, sadly, a lot of the mainstream establishment they have split.
Yeah. Where's the sponsorship as well? Pfizer ain't going to sponsor that, are they?
No, I don't think so. the bit where he comes along at the end, dear old Jordan realises now, and he's also probably, he's had a little drink.
Yeah.
Who knows what else? He works at Big Pharma. Who knows what kind of chems are involved? Let's have a look.
You work for Pfizer. My question for you is why is Pfizer want to hide from the public the fact that they're mutating the COVID viruses.
Is this real life? What is happening?
Is this real life is a sort of a meme from that kid that went to the dentist, isn't it? Like,
oh,
sat in the back of a car and he's had some medication and he's for the first time realizing.
Charlie.
Yeah, little Charlie. He's realizing. Is it Charlie? That's the big one.
Bit my finger. Is it not that one?
No, this kid's been. He's taking some medicine and he's realizing that the subjective world alters and that there potentially is no objective non-local reality. The reality shifts depending on, neurological function and a whole series of variants. Well, this is where dear old Jordan's gone. Is this real life?
Mm.
It is real life.
Yeah.
As far as we can tell, I mean, although the laws of physics do start to fall apart at the level of the subparticular world, which
gets so spiritual so quickly, seemingly out of nowhere. I can't follow
it. Inject yourself with this electron and spin that one in the opposite direction, you're still fucked. It's gone a bit mad now. I don't like that vibe. Things are spilling, laptops are dropping. iPads are being knocked over. It's got a bit. That's a bit
sad now. I don't
know
what is his point at this junction. What is his point? What's he trying to achieve?
I think he should have gone home then.
Yeah.
I think the minute that guy said, "Excuse me, I'm from Project Veritas. We've been filming you." That geezer on the date
tell you
number
what,
three.
Albert Baller's going to be furious because Baller did it expertly at Davos, didn't he? When he was followed around for about half an hour.
He was pursued there by Rebel News, by that lad Abby, I think he's called, and by the dude that runs Rebel News, like tag teaming him. And Baller, nothing.
Absolutely.
You ain't getting nothing out of Baller. He just keeps his mouth shut till he gets onto a CNN panel, and then he's like, oh, share price is changing.
I'd have liked to see Baller do this, though.
Shut up!
Is this real life?
Is this real life? Well, not really. You're in a sort of highly conditioned environment now in the Alps, in the rarefied cuckoo clock air. I just have a little,
Please unlock the door. Please unlock the door.
He also demanded that they lock the door and they tracked the Project Veritas, isn't it? I think Jimmy Dore's ready. Jimmy, if you don't know Jimmy Dore now, then by God, you're going to love Jimmy Dore. Jimmy Dore is the host of the Jimmy Dore Show, which is available on Rumble. He's speaking at the Rage Against the War Machine rally at the Lincoln Memorial on Sunday, February the 19th. We'll be talking about that a little bit more. You there, Jimmy? You all right, mate?
Yes, I'm here. Good to talk to you.
I watched your video where you talked about this. What do you think about this story, Jimmy Dore?
I think it's there's a lot of things you can say about this story. One, it shows you the amoral character of people who in positions of power at pharma companies, right? He was sitting there bragging about how what they're doing is good for their bottom line, but bad for America and bad for people. And he was giggling about it. And you know he was. The thing is that he said, oh, I was lying to impress someone on a date. Who lies like that? Who says something like, hey, I don't know if you like me yet, but I'm involved in a bunch of nefarious, illegal scientific experiments that are deadly to the world. Are you wet yet? Huh? How you feel? Are you horny? So no one
are you
horny? Like that to try to get in someone's pants. All right. So there was that. But the
I don't know, man. I've heard people like lie about being thugs and stuff. I think people do lie like that sometimes.
Like
to be honest.
Twitter files. The Democrat people in America, the people who consider themselves left but actually aren't. They immediately dismissed it because they didn't like the guy who was holding the camera. So they can't. There's no context that would make what that guy was saying okay, and there was no context that would make what Project Veritas was doing un-okay. That was all okay. That was what you're supposed to be doing. Journalists won't do it because they're paid by Big Pharma. So that was the other thing. How they can just dismiss it. Same thing with the Twitter files. So we've been lied to. What this reveals is that, of course, every suspicion you had about Big Pharma and the COVID narrative is true. And that we've been lied to on such an unimaginable scale that our minds can't comprehend it. And they're still doing it today. I just did a story yesterday where UK is ending their booster program, and they're not going to offer boosters to people under 50 years old who are healthy because there's no need. In the United States today, I woke up to a headline from CNN saying COVID is the eighth leading cause of death for children in America.
What?
Which that sounds horrible if you glance at it, and most people only read the headlines. People don't know that children are at a less of risk from COVID than they are from the flu. And that people who are doing this and doing headlines like that are what we used to call psychopaths, because that's what they are. They're psychopath killers, and your children have zero risk from COVID, but they want to put a untested gene therapy in your kid so we can make more money. That's how psychopathic these people are. You mean the people who put asbestos in baby powder and then when they got caught kept selling it to poor people? Yes, those people. You mean the people who sold AIDS-tainted blood clotting medicine to poor countries that they knew was going to give people AIDS? Yes, those people. You mean the people who got half the country hooked on heroin? Yes, those people. You mean the people who sold you Vioxx that they knew was going to kill you with a heart attack but didn't care because they knew they were going to make $6 billion off it and the fine would be less than the money they made? Those are the people that we weren't allowed to criticize. And you know the old saying, who you're not allowed to criticize is who rules over you. So went from deplatforming guys like Alex Jones, which I was against from the moment it happened because I knew where it was headed. We went from Alex Jones to the leading doctors and scientists in their fields to ex-presidents, now to anybody who goes against Bill Gates and the establishment narrative. I got a phony YouTube did a strike on my channel, which was completely bogus bullshit, and the guy who was doing it to me knew it was, and they were doing it at the behest of who? I can only guess, since the Twitter files came out. But I got a strike because I said that the vaccine didn't stop transmission of the virus, which it does not. And so when I told them that the facts don't fall, they just switched it. Then YouTube said, well, that's not why we gave you a strike. We gave you a strike because you said it doesn't stop contraction. They just changed the rationale for giving me a strike overnight once I showed them that even the FDA didn't agree with their conclusion. Bill Gates did, and the WHO does, because Bill Gates funds the WHO, which is why we get to hear from a college dropout on issues of international medicine and health. Why are we listening to that guy? Because he has a lot of money. He's the gangster. Bill Gates is not a guy who's out there looking out for your best interest. He's not doing philanthropy. What Bill Hicks is a nefarious motherfucker. And who wants control? He is a goddamn maniac. How do you become a billionaire? By helping people? You become a billionaire by fucking crushing people and doing the shit he just did by investing $55 billion in 2019 in biotech. In 2019, the guy's a genius. Him and Nancy Pelosi are the greatest stock buyers in the history of stock. How did they know that there would be this crazy pandemic that the WHO would then mandate everybody have to take this goddamn thing? that he just invested in, and then he made $550 million, and now he's, what's the technical term? Now he's shitting on the virus. So now he's shitting, I'm on the vaccine. Now he says the vaccine's worthless, and we gotta get, now he's got a new thing he's selling. It's something that you can inhale, that it could, why am I always hearing from a goddamn psychopathic college dropout about the next medical innovation that everybody else is gonna be mandated to take? Why? Because the world is corrupt and run by a handful of fucking millionaires, which is why I live in a country where even though we went through what they called was a deadly pandemic, they still won't give us health care. We still are in a $100 billion war in Ukraine while people are living under every bridge in this country. I can go on and on, but that video tells you everything you need to know about this culture. What's wrong with society? What's wrong with government? Because the people who don't want you to see that video are the same people who own the governments. That's in the United States anyway. I don't know how it works in Europe, but they are owned in the United States, which is why you're not allowed to criticize the vaccine, you're not allowed to criticize the COVID policy, and anybody who did was immediately smeared in the corporate press. People who were the leaders in their field, Russell, the leading cardiologists, the leading vaccinologists, they tried to make them look like kooks and crazies, which they did, and people still think that they are, but they're not, and now the tide is finally starting to turn because Pfizer, like idiots, stopped advertising on Twitter, and the next day you were allowed to tell the truth about COVID and the vaccine on Twitter, and so now everybody is starting to hear the truth about COVID.
Wow, I'm gonna play that speech before we broadcast to myself to inspire me and to remind us that we're on the right track. Jimmy, it's so beautiful to hear you articulate that and to stitch together personal values and ethics as you did.
I was worried about articulating that, given that for sure.
Lad from Pfizer there, with the degree of corruption that we're all currently experiencing. We're living in a kind of wasteland now, governed by greed, where we're unable to gain access to truthful information, where people will use any excuse to keep counter narratives out of the public sphere, condemning dissenting voices, smearing them when necessary. And it's not only with this subject, it's with any subject where they want absolute sovereignty over the way that the story is told. I'm assuming that you're participating in this anti-war rally later this month, Jimmy, because you believe that the reporting on the Ukraine-Russia conflict is similarly biased and probably due to a similar set of interests.
Well, they had the same kind of restrictions on us on YouTube. I'm sure you understand it, that we weren't allowed to tell that the war crimes being committed by the Ukraine Nazis and then trying to blame it on the Russians. We couldn't say that because that would be denying a mass casualty kill or violent act, which we weren't. It happened, but what they said didn't happen. The Russians in Bucha we're talking about. So we were debunking that. We had Scott Ritter on. They're not allowing, again, it's so they have to have narrative control. And in the United States, there used to be 50 giant news media companies, right? In 1996, Bill Clinton got rid of that regulation, and now that all the we have concentrated power of the media. We have six companies in America, so everybody in journalism has to work for one of the six billionaire-owned media companies if they want to have a career. And those people get their funding from where? Military-industrial complex, Wall Street, Big Pharma, and the health insurance companies. So they control the narrative. We don't have free speech in America. If you want to have it on social media, and if you do have a counter narrative, you immediately get smeared. No, I've been smeared, but I'm a pothead comedian, so it's easy to do that to me. But they did it to Robert Malone, the guy who invented the mRNA vaccine technology at the Salk Institute. They made him seem like he was some kind of quack without a degree, and like a guy who, they call him an anti-vaxxer. The guy has worked on vaccines his entire life, and so that's the laziest smear, and that's all they can do. But now with the Ukraine, they're sending $100 billion. And so what the United States media does is they start the story about Ukraine. They start the story at the Russia's invasion of the Donbass. They don't ever start with in 2014 when the United States and the CIA instituted a coup. And how did we do that? We got in bed with right-wing Nazis to overthrow a democratically elected president of Ukraine who was more friendly to Russia than they was to the European economic model. Now, why was he more friendly to the Russian economic model than European? Because the Europeans are neoliberal worker crushers, and they wanted him to, they wanted Ukraine to now give up all their social, give up social programs, give up pensions, give up taking care of workers' rights. That's what they wanted. He didn't want to do it. That CIA instituted a coup, overthrew him. The United States, the people in America have no idea that happened. Then they installed a government that is friendlier to Russia. And then, you know, Zelensky actually, when he campaigned on uniting the country. He campaigned on ending the war and peace. And then, of course, the CIA, NATO, and the right-wing Nazis inside Ukraine won't let him do that. And so he's a puppet. So I kind of feel sorry for Zelensky. He's a puppet of these people, and he knows he'll be killed if he goes, if he, look what happened. Look what happens when someone stands up against the United States. Look what happened to Muammar Gaddafi. That he doesn't want that to happen to him, right? So he's going along with this. And so what people don't realize is, so why is there a war in Ukraine in the first place? It's because the United States is afraid of Germany and Russia coming together in an economic fashion. What they're afraid of is Russian manpower and natural resources combining with German capital and technology, and then they would be the economic force that the United States couldn't compete with. And so we're doing this. Why do we blow up the Nord Stream pipeline? Why do we want Germany to be at war with Russia? Because we don't want them to come together, because it's all about economics. As always, if there's a United States involved in a war, it's about stealing natural resources or about hegemony. And so right now, the United States, because Russia was selling up to 40% of the energy to Europe. So the United States wants some of that market. So now we're selling liquefied natural gas at higher prices to Europe than we are at home. And they're trying to get people in the United States to use less natural gas so they can sell more at higher prices in Europe. And Europe is going along because they're being bullied by the economic hegemon that is the United States. I don't know why they're still they're still going along. They're hurting their own people. We had the prime minister or the foreign minister of Germany say that she's committed to the Ukraine people, and she doesn't care what her own people say. What kind of a political leader says that? Is that somebody who's completely compromised by the security state? Is that somebody who they have compromise on? What is going on that somebody would ignore their own people's feelings over another country? So I'm just letting you know that when America sends $100 billion to another country, it has nothing to do with those people. What we're actually doing is using the Ukrainian people as cannon fodder in a proxy war that the United States, NATO, and the West are waging. And so everybody predicted that what we did was provoke Russia into entering the Donbass and invading Ukraine. We've been provoking that for 4 years. In fact, the ex-chancellor of Germany just admitted that the whole Minsk peace accord, so there was a peace accord in 2014, and what it did was there was a civil war happening in Ukraine. The Ukraine government was bombing the Donbass. Those are the Russian-speaking Ukrainians in the east part of Ukraine, and they wanted to be separate. They didn't want to go along with the coup. They didn't want to, and so they had a peace agreement that said, we're going to stop shelling you, and we're going to give you even some autonomy, and everything's going to be okay. And that was going to be enforced by France and Germany and everybody else. They never enforced it. Ukraine never stopped bombing the Russian-speaking people in the Donbass, and then they ramped it up. So the reason why they had that peace accord, the German chancellor admitted, was to give Ukraine enough time to build up their military, so then when they finally did provoke Russia to invade Ukraine, they would have a big enough military to fight them off. So that was provoked. The bombing of the Ukraine and went up twice as much in the months before Russia invaded. So again, what's happening, and people in the United States have no idea what's happening in the Ukraine. What's worse is they have no idea that they have no idea what's happening in Ukraine. Right now, we're calling Putin a madman who invaded his neighbors as the United States is occupying a third of Syria. And why are we occupying a third of Syria? For the oil. How do I know that? Because the president of the United States said that on camera, that the reason why he has troops in Syria is so we can steal their oil. And so somehow that's okay, and somehow Russia's bad. And we're still committing a genocide in Yemen, and we did 20 years in Afghanistan. United States are America's terrorists, and the American people have no idea what our government is doing in our name overseas, and they have no idea what's happening in Ukraine. It's another proxy war for economic and for corporations. Read the book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman. Every time there's a Marine or an American soldier somewhere. Oh. It's at the behest of a capitalist.
It's extraordinary that, and brilliant, that you make the distinction between the American people and the American elites that operate on behalf of global corporatists. Wasn't it astonishing to see Zelensky crop up at the Golden Globes in a beautiful piece of propaganda? Isn't it alarming to hear Zelensky list the names of the global corporatists that will be charged with rebuilding Ukraine? JP Morgan, Goldman Sachs, BlackRock, these great Goliaths, listed as if they were the Avengers, as if they were great heroes on the world stage. Jimmy, before your participation today in this conversation, I thought that the list of demands that the anti-war rally that you're participating in were quite egregious and ridiculous, but having heard your oratory today, I think you might just get them. Let's have a look at the list of demands that the march on February the 19th are advocating for. Not one more penny for the war in Ukraine, negotiate peace, stop the war inflation, disband NATO, that's a good one. Global nuclear de-escalation, cut the military budget in half, and return those funds to the American people, abolish the CIA. Can we just cut Jimmy Dore off there? Because I just saw the page of... Oh, mate, we've got Jimmy there. Like, when you hear those policies being put forward, it makes you recognize that what's required is a new political movement outside of the intransigent binary political systems that currently operate both within Washington and in most places in the world, usually on behalf of global corporatists. Jimmy, are you there, and how do you feel about those demands being met? Feels like we don't have Jimmy right there. I'll tell you what, that was an incredible performance from Jimmy Dore. I mean, I thought it was amazing. Hey, Jimmy, did you see the list of demands there, mate?
Yes, I did see the list of demands. Those are pretty bold demands. I would like to invite anybody who's against the war in Ukraine, for whatever reason, to join us. So those are 10 demands. Those are pretty big demands. I think we might even be mixing some issues there. So I don't care what you feel about any of those other demands, but if you are against the war in Ukraine, I invite you to join us February 19th at the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. If you're against war, show up. And if you're against the Ukraine war, that's the important thing. And I also want to challenge the people on the left, like the people who claim to be on the left but aren't. People like the Squad, people like AOC, people like Ro Khanna, who said he's against war, but he's for Ukraine, right? So I want them to look into their heart, their supposed lefty heart, and be against this Ukraine war, because this is nothing but a proxy war, and people are getting slaughtered by the tens of thousands. So if you're against war, show up. If you're if you're against all the bad things happening because of war, which like inflation, show up. And I, of course, support Julian Assange 100% because I support freedom of the press. And so if you're for the freedom of the press, show up. But you don't have to support. I don't think you have to support all those things. I just care if you're against the war. If you want to end the Ukraine war, show up. I don't think you have to agree with all those demands. Just be against the Ukraine war. That's all I care about. That's the important thing. And we can work on the other things.
Demands is dismantling the machinery of global capitalism. When we if you can support the rally, even if you can't join Jimmy and the others physically, by making a donation, we'll post the information in the chat if you're interested in doing that. When you see a list of radical demands like that, Jimmy, it makes it all the clearer that what's really required is a new political movement that is external to the Washington machine. It's impossible to have conversations about freedom of the press, freedom of the media, a true anti-war movement. The possibility, as we discussed last time you were on the show, of people that are anti-establishment coming together regardless of whether their views are progressive or traditional, left or right. We all have more in common with one another at this point than we do with these marginal establishment centralist elites that are dominating all of our institutions, dominating the narrative and making even conversations like this one difficult. So I'm so grateful to have you on, to be able to have this chat, man.
Joe Biden has more in common with Donald Trump and Mitch McConnell than I have in common with him or Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton has more in common than Mitch McConnell than she has with me. So let's keep that in mind, right? So yes, and right now, the only people speaking out against this Ukraine war or imperialism in general are people on the far right in the United States. People like Thomas Massie, people like Marjorie Taylor Greene, who was pilloried, but she's right on Ukraine. And so I don't care if you're wrong on everything else. I don't care if I disagree with you on everything else. But if you're right about Ukraine and you realize that this is a proxy war that we need to end and stand up, then you can join us. And that's what I'm all about. February 19th, ending the war. United people in America don't want the war. Right now, the far right wing of the Republican Party just won the right to have a vote on ending these wars. Now, before Nancy Pelosi wouldn't let that happen, a Democrat. And that's because we have two right-wing parties in this country. We don't have a left-wing party in America. We have two pro-war, pro-Wall Street parties in America, anti-worker parties. And so that's where we're at in this culture. And why? Because, again, I don't know what's happening over in Europe, but in the United States, our government is completely captured by corporations. And the military-industrial complex, at the snap of a finger, can get $100 billion sent to the most corrupt country in Europe. And we don't even know where that money's going. In fact, not only are that we don't not know where it's going, but when people want to track the money, people in power in the United States, in our Congress, block that legislation at the behest of the military-industrial complex. So we can't even track where that. So this is 100% corruption, and that's the thing about Americans. They don't realize that. They think their government is regular corrupt. Like, oh, Trump gave his son a job, Biden gave his son a job. That's regular corruption. What they don't realize is that the whole entire war is corrupt. It's all one big grift. What they don't realize is the entire military-industrial complex is a big grift. We spend 10 times more in our military than the rest of the goddamn world combined. We are completely corrupted in America. This is not any. People try to say, oh, we have to vote to save our democracy. We haven't had democracy in the United States for decades, and that is not hyperbole. Your government, your democracy was stolen from you decades ago, right? Which is why half the country is poor, low income, 80% of workers live paycheck to paycheck, 50% of wage earners earn less than $30,000 a year. Nobody has health. We still don't have health care in America. You go bankrupt if you get sick. You get bankrupt if you go to college. And we're spending endless trillions of dollars on empire and war while we still have people living under every bridge. You know, I get up in comedy clubs in Los Angeles where people don't know I'm going to be there, so they're not my fans. So when I get on stage, I'm talking to regular people, a cross-section of America, and I'll say, hey, you know, isn't it amazing we can send $100 billion to Ukraine? And you know, if we're sending $100 billion in weapons to a country, it's because we care about their people. Everybody laughs when I say that. And then I say, I don't care if they send $100 billion to Ukraine. I just wish they would send $100 billion to the United States. And the crowds go crazy because they realize we're living in a completely corrupted society. So what we need now is for people to lose all hope in the system. So what the AOC and Bernie Sanders are there to do is to keep you believing that the system is going to somehow serve you. It is not. The system is there to crush you while it extracts wealth upwards, which is exactly what they did with COVID. They did a thing called the CARES Act. That was their legislation to help people during COVID. What it was a $5 trillion grift that took money from the U.S. Treasury and gave it to the richest couple of thousand people in the country. You know, in other countries, when they did lockdowns, they made sure the workers got their paycheck. You know, they didn't do that in the United States. They did it in every other country except here. They just locked you down. Then they promised they were going to give you $2,000 in relief, and they didn't even do that. They gave you $1,400. So they've been crushing people in America. And what the establishment has been doing, they implemented a controlled demolition of our economy. And what they want you to do is blame your neighbor for the pain you're feeling because of that, because your neighbor wouldn't take a vaccine that didn't work the way they said it did in the first place. Well, I'm not going to hate my neighbor, and I'm not going to blame my neighbor for the pain I'm feeling, because he's being crushed just like everybody else by the same oligarchs. I'm going to join with my neighbor, and I'm going to oppose the oligarchy, and that's the thing that scares them the most. And when the left and the right realize we have more in common that separates us, and we share a common enemy, that's actually how shit gets done. And that's why I'm inviting people from the Republican Party, people from the Democratic Party, from the Green Party. I hope the Green Party can show up and be anti-war. It would be nice to see the Green Party actually be anti-war. So it would,
yeah,
I'm inviting everybody from all, I don't care if you're a socialist, a communist, a libertarian, a right-wing Republican, a left-wing Democrat. I implore you to show up and fight against the hegemony, the imperialism, the war machine that is raping the world and stealing our future.
Jimmy Dore there. What a fantastic set of speeches from Jimmy Dore. You can join him Rage Against the War Machine on Sunday, February the 19th, and you can support that. We'll put a link in the description if you're unable to attend. If you want to see Jimmy live, you can go to jimmydore.com right now to get your tickets to see Jimmy live. Jimmy, that was a really beautiful, inspiring, and invigorating. I mean, I think I essentially was a viewer for that incredible oratory. Thank you for your ongoing passion. Thanks for your brilliance. We're coming to your country soon. We're going to be in LA, Jimmy, so we'll come and check you if that's possible.
When? I would love to see you. Sure. Are you doing shows?
Yeah, maybe I'll come check you. Like, if you're live around like the beginning of March, and we're going to be in the US from like the end of February and then for the first week of March, I'd love to do some stand-up out there and see if you've got this unified hybrid audience that you're curating over there. I'd love to participate. Great work you're doing.
Okay. I'll set it up. I'll set up a show. We'd love to have you.
Jimmy, thanks so much, man. Lots of love. He's on Rumble. You can watch Jimmy every day on Rumble as well. That was a fantastic contribution, wasn't it? Yeah, it was good.
I just thought, like you said, everyone should be watching this. Everyone should watch that. It's like that guy's spitting truths.
Yeah, it's beautiful to hear it conveyed from a perspective that is undeniably altruistic and philanthropic about caring for ordinary people, the irrelevance of our cultural differences when it comes to galling inequality of the scale that's being described, and corruption that is truly global. I think that's beautiful from Jimmy Dore. That should be on the curriculum at any school for people that are, you know, that are going to change the world, certainly. Hey, guess who we've got on the show tomorrow? We've got Len McCluskey, a former union leader, talking to us about the necessity for creating new political movements. On Thursday, we've got Jimmy Tobias talking about the Wuhan lab leak theory and the control around that narrative. And on Friday, we're talking about spiritual awakening and the necessity for personal wellness and connection with Deepak Chopra, who was one of the first people to point out that the pharmaceutical industry are moving into spaces that more holistic healing could control and contain if we were better awakened. And again, during the pandemic, it became clear that we weren't given information about well-being and health and exercising and eating well. I mean, there's so much to discuss. That's why we broadcast every single day at the same time. You can watch us on Catch Up. Sign up to our really locals annoying community for our weekly show, Stay Why? Connected, where we respond directly to your questions. And also, you'll get a first look at my stand-up special when it drops soon. Download our daily podcast, Stay Free with Russel Brand. And you can catch Silky Carlo talking about government spying and former CIA analyst Martin Guri talking about how the centralized establishment have not caught up with our ability to communicate and share information. And that's what this new movement towards censorship is about. Join us tomorrow, not for more of the same, but for more of the different. Until then, stay free.
So annoying. Jesus. Why? Why be this way? Could you just not? I'd really appreciate it if you just didn't. I can't fix it right now. I'm not on stream. Well, hold on. Let me see if I can.
Is that gonna work? Does it work? I don't know. I feel like my noise might be too high now. I'm gonna cut myself out. Yeah, I think I'm hearing myself cut. Jesus, what is odd? It's gotta be so difficult. Alright. Can you hear me more normally now? Without me cutting out? Yeah, I think so. I still have the key click problem. Fix that. Alright, I'll have to worry about this later. So how about that news, though? That guy was an orator of some talent, for sure. I got another video ready to play, but since the party is still in wait mode for our tank, I kind of want to see if I can research this audio problem a little bit.
What's up, guys? In today's keyboard on Switch, let's get into the tutorial tab. Here you want to set your sample rules as the mic audio device, and apply this one too. OBS might ask you to restart the program to apply the changes, so just do that. Next, open up your recording devices by right-clicking on the sound icon. Double-click on your microphone and select Advanced. Here you want to change the format to 48 kHz too. Don't forget to apply the change. Open up your recording devices by right-clicking on the sound icon. Double-click on your microphone and select Advanced. Here you want to change the format to 48 kHz too. Don't forget to apply the change. Finally, go back to OBS and press on the little gear icon from your microphone and select Filter. Don't forget on the sound icon. Double click on your microphone and select Advanced. Here you want to change the format to 48 kHz too. Don't forget to apply the change. Finally, go back to OBS and press on the little gear icon from your microphone and select Filters. Press on the plus at the bottom left and select Noise Gate. This is the noise border at which your microphone will get picked up by the software. You can copy my settings and try it out, but this changes for everyone. The open threshold setting should be at least at the volume of your voice. We will add one more filter called Noise Suppression. I recommend to set this to about minus 24 dB. If you set it too low, then your voice will sound too metallic. I really want you to play around with these two filters a bit, to make sure that only your voice gets picked up. Also, if you don't see all of the filter settings, then you will have to update.
Okay. That does seem better. I think it's being mostly blocked. We'll have to call that good for now.
One's being with certain capacities like one's arms and legs and mouth and teeth and brain, which could always be used constructively. And I feel it's for this reason that I have always remained for myself in the position of the comparative philosopher, wanting to balance East and West rather than to go overboard with enthusiasm for exotic imports. But there are aspects of Jung's work far beyond this that I want to discuss. And first of all, I want to call attention to one fundamental principle that underlay all his work and that was most extraordinarily exemplified in Jung himself as a person. And this is what I would call his recognition of the polarity of life. That is to say, his resistance to what is, to my mind, the disastrous and absurd hypothesis that there is in this universe a radical and absolute conflict between good and evil, light and darkness, that can never, never, never be harmonized. This conflict has come up to us in a very vivid way in recent days with the trial of Adolf Eichmann. And with Arthur Koestler's passionate denunciation of any sort of philosophy of life, and he's thinking in mind, he has in mind particularly Eastern philosophies like Buddhism and Hinduism, which so slur the absolute differences between good and evil that in their name one could justify the sort of crimes which were committed in the concentration camps of Germany. And it's interesting too, certain people accused Jung also of Nazi sympathies because he too would not subscribe to the absolute state of a war between good and evil, going down to the very roots of the universe. Obviously, when certain crimes and catastrophes occur, human emotions are deeply and rightly aroused. And I would, for myself, say that were I in any situation where an Eichmann was operating, I would be roused to a degree of fury that I can hardly imagine in my present existence, but I know it would come out from me. I would oppose...
How can you be so certain?
...those sorts of villainy with all the energy that I have. And if I was trapped in that situation, I would fight it to the end. But at the same time, I would recognize the relativity of my own emotional involvement. I would know that I was fighting a man like Eichmann in the same way, shall we say, as a spider and a wasp, insects which naturally prey upon one another and fight one another, do so. But as a human being, I would not be able to regard my adversary as a metaphysical devil. That is to say, as one who represented the principle of absolute and unresolvable evil. And I think this is the most important thing in Jung, that he was able to point out that to the degree that you condemn others and find evil in others, You are to that degree unconscious of the same thing in yourself. Or at least of the potentiality of it. There can be Eichmanns and Hitlers and Himmlers just because there are people who are unconscious of their own dark side. And they project that darkness outward into, say, Jews or communists or whatever the enemy may be, and say, there is the darkness, it is not in me. And therefore, because the darkness is not in me, I am justified in annihilating this enemy, whether it be with atom bombs or gas chambers or whatnot. But to the degree that a person becomes conscious that the evil is as much in himself as in the other, to this same degree he is not likely to project it onto some scapegoat and permit the most commit the most criminal acts of violence on other people. Now this is to me the primary thing that Jung saw, that in order to admit and really accept and understand the evil in oneself, one had to be able to do it without being an enemy. As he put it, you had to accept your own dark side. And he had this preeminently in his own character. I had a long talk with him back in 1958. And I was enormously impressed with a man who's obviously very great, but at the same time, with whom everyone could be completely at ease. There are so many great people, great in knowledge or great in what is called holiness, with whom the ordinary individual feels rather embarrassed. He feels inclined to sit on the edge of his chair and to feel immediately judged by this person's wisdom or sanctity. Jung managed to have wisdom, and I think also sanctity, in such a way that when other people came into its presence, they didn't feel judged. They felt enhanced, encouraged, and invited to share in a common life. And there was a sort of twinkle in Jung's eye that gave me the impression that he knew himself to be just as much a villain as everybody else. There's a nice German word, Hintergedanke, which means a thought in the very far, far back of your mind. Jung had a Hintergedanke in the back of his mind, which showed, it showed in the twinkle in his eye, it showed that he knew and recognized what I've sometimes called the element of irreducible rascality in himself.
Irreducible rascality.
And he knew it so strongly and so clearly, and in a way so lovingly, that he would not condemn the same thing in others, and therefore would not be led into those thoughts, feelings, and acts of violence towards others, which are always characteristic of people who project the devil in themselves upon the outside, upon somebody else, upon the scapegoat. Now this made Jung a very integrated character. In other words, here I have to present a little bit of a complex idea. He was a man who was thoroughly with himself, having seen and accepted his own nature profoundly. He had a kind of unity and absence of conflict in his own nature, which had to it this additional complication that I find so fascinating. He was the sort of man who could feel anxious and afraid and guilty without being ashamed of feeling this way.
Ooh. I aspire to that one.
In other words, he understood that an integrated person is not a person who simply eliminated the sense of guilt or the sense of anxiety from his life, who is fearless and wooden and kind of sage of stone. He's a person who feels all these things, but has no recrimination against himself for feeling them. And this is, to my mind, a profound kind of humor. You know, in humor, there's always a certain element of malice. There was a talk given on the Pacifica station just a little while ago, which was an interview with Al Capp. And Al Capp made the point that he felt that all humor was fundamentally malicious. Now, there's a very high kind of humor, which is humor at oneself. Real humor is not jokes at the expense of others. It's always jokes at the expense of oneself, and of course it has an element of malice in it. It has malice towards oneself, the recognition of the fact that behind the social role that you assume, behind all your pretensions to being either a good citizen or a fine scholar or a great scientist or a leading politician or physician or whatever you happen to be, but behind this facade there is a certain element of the unreconstructed bum. Not as something to be condemned and wailed over, but as something to be recognized as contributive to one's greatness and to one's positive aspects in the same way that manure is contributive to the perfume of the rose. Jung saw this and Jung accepted this. And I want to read a passage from one of his lectures, which I think is one of the greatest things he ever wrote, and which has been
a
very marvelous thing for me. It was in a lecture delivered to a group of clergy in Switzerland a considerable number of years ago, and he writes as follows. People forget that even doctors have moral scruples, and that certain patients' confessions are hard even for a doctor to swallow. Yet the patient does not feel himself accepted, unless the very worst in him is accepted too. No one can bring this about by mere words. It comes only through reflection, and through the doctor's attitude towards himself and his own dark side. If the doctor wants to guide another, or even accompany him a step of the way, he must feel with that person his psyche. He never feels it when he passes judgment. Whether he puts his judgments into words or keeps them to himself makes not the slightest difference. To take the opposite position and to agree with the patient offhand is also of no use. Feeling comes only through unprejudiced objectivity. This sounds almost like a scientific precept, and it could be confused with a purely intellectual, abstract attitude of mind. But what I mean is something quite different. It is a human quality, a kind of deep respect for the facts, for the man who suffers from them, and for the riddle of such a man's life. The truly religious person has this attitude. He knows that God has brought all sorts of strange and inconceivable things to pass, and seeks in the most curious ways to enter a man's heart. He therefore senses in everything the unseen presence of the divine will. This is what I mean by unprejudiced objectivity. It is a moral achievement on the part of the doctor, who ought not to let himself be repelled by sickness and corruption.
So if he's calling it a moral achievement, he's saying that it is actually a virtue of morality to be able to not judge other people's lack of morality. Which kind of sounds almost contradictory. I think it's not, but it definitely, you know, has that connotation to it, at least seems to have that connotation to it, in the sense that only by judging other people's morality do we usually, you know, deny that as a possible course of action. Deny that as a way to be.
We cannot change anything unless we accept it.
That's something I've been hearing over and over again.
Condemnation does not liberate. It oppresses. I am the oppressor of the person I condemn, not his friend and fellow sufferer. I do not in the least mean to say that we...
I like that term, fellow sufferer, too. We're all suffering, to some extent or another. And adding to that, to another human being suffering, is, such a waste of potential human behavior.
We must never pass judgment when we desire to help and improve. But if the doctor wishes to help a human being, he must be able to accept him as he is. And he can do this in reality only when he has already seen and accepted himself as he is. Perhaps this sounds very simple, but simple things are always the most difficult.
True that.
In actual life, it requires the greatest art to be simple. And so acceptance of oneself is the essence of the moral problem and the acid test of one's whole outlook on life. That I feed the beggar, that I forgive an insult, that I love my enemy in the name of Christ, all these are undoubtedly great virtues. What I do unto the least of my brethren, that I do unto Christ. But what if I should discover that the least amongst them all, the poorest of all beggars, the most impudent of all offenders, yea, the very fiend himself, that these are within me, and that I myself stand in need of the alms of my own kindness? That I myself am the enemy who must be loved, what then? Then, as a rule, the whole truth of Christianity is reversed. There is then no more talk of love and long-suffering. We say to the brother within us, Raka, and condemn and rage against ourselves. We hide him from the world. We deny ever having met this least among the lowly in ourselves, and had it been God himself who drew near to us and was desperately before him. You should have denied him a thousand times before it seems impossible. Well, you may think the metaphors rather strong, but I feel that they are not so needlessly. This is a very, very forceful passage and a memorable one in all Jung's works. Trying to heal this insanity from which our culture in particular has suffered, of thinking that a human being can become hale, healthy, and whole by being divided against himself in inner conflict, paralleling the conception of a cosmic conflict between an absolute good and an absolute evil, which cannot be reduced to any prior and underlying unity. In other words, our rage, and our very proper rage, against evil things which occur in this world, must not overstep itself. For if we require, as a justification for our rage, a fundamental and metaphysical division between good and evil, we have an insane and, in a certain sense, schizophrenic universe, of which no sense whatsoever can be made. All conflict Jung was saying, all opposition has its resolution in an underlying unity. You cannot understand the meaning of to be unless you understand the meaning of not to be. You cannot understand the meaning of good unless you understand the meaning of evil. Even St. Thomas Aquinas saw this, for he said that just as it is the silent pause which gives sweetness to the chant, so it is suffering, and so it is evil, which makes possible the recognition of virtue. This is not, as Jung tries to explain, a philosophy of condoning the evil. To take the opposite position, he said, and to agree with the patient offhand is also of no use, but estranges him, the doctor, or estranges him, the patient, as much as condemnation. Let me continue further, reading from this extraordinary passage. Healing may be called, Jung says, a religious problem. In the sphere of social or national relations, the state of suffering may be civil war, and this state is to be cured by the Christian virtue of forgiveness and love of one's enemies. That which we recommend with the conviction of good Christians is applicable to external situations. We must also apply inwardly in the treatment of neurosis. This is why modern man has heard enough about guilt and sin. He is sorely beset by his own bad conscience, and wants rather to know how he is to reconcile himself with his own nature, how he is to love the enemy in his own heart and call the wolf his brother. The modern man does not want to know in what way he can imitate Christ, but in what way he can live his own individual life, however meager and uninteresting it may be. It is because every form of imitation seems to him deadening and sterile that he rebels against the force of tradition that would hold him to well-trodden ways. All such roads for him lead in the wrong direction. He may not know it, but he behaves as if his own individual life for God's special will, which must be fulfilled at all costs. This is the source of his egoism, which is one of the most tangible evils of the neurotic state. But the person who tells him he is too egoistic has already lost his confidence, and rightly so, for that person has driven him still further into his neurosis. If I wish to effect a cure for my patients, I am forced to acknowledge the deep significance of their egoism. I should be blind indeed if I did not recognize it as a true will of God. I must even help the patient to prevail in his egoism. If he succeeds in this, he estranges himself from other people. He drives them away, and they come to themselves, as they should, for they were seeking to rob him of his sacred egoism. This must be left to him, for it is his strongest and healthiest power. It is, as I have said, a true will of God, which sometimes drives him into complete isolation. However wretched this state may be, it also stands him in good stead. For in this way alone will he get to know himself and learn what an invaluable treasure is the love of his fellow beings. It is, moreover, only in the state of complete abandonment and loneliness that we experience the helpful powers of our own natures. End of quote. This is a very striking example of Jung's power to comprehend and integrate points of view as well as psychological attitudes that seem on the surface to be completely antithetical. For example, even
great wisdom is paradoxical.
When he was devoting himself to the study of Eastern philosophy, he had some difficulty in comprehending the, let's say, the Buddhistic denial of the reality of the ego. But you can see that in practice, in what he was actually trying to get, he was moving towards the same position that is intended in both the Hindu and the Buddhist much philosophy about the nature of the ego. Just, for example, as the Hindus will say, that the I principle in man is not really a separate ego, but an expression of the universal life of Brahman or the Godhead. So Jung is saying here that the development of the ego in man is a true will of God, and that it is only by following the ego that one, and developing it to its full extent, that one fulfills the function which this, you might say, temporary illusion has in man's psychic life. For he goes on and says here, when one has several times seen this development at work, one can no longer deny that what was evil has turned to good, and that what seemed good has kept alive the forces of evil. The archdemon of egoism leads us along the royal road to that ingathering which religious experience demands. What we observe here is a fundamental law of life, enantiodromia, or conversion into the opposite. And it is this that makes possible the reunion of the warring halves of the personality, and thereby brings the civil war to an end. End of quote. In other words, he was seeing that, as Blake said, a fool who persists in his folly will become wise.
Indeed.
That the development of egoism in man is not something to be overcome or better integrated by opposition to it, but by following it. It's almost, isn't it, the principle of judo, not overcoming what appears to be a hostile force by opposing it, but by swinging with the punch, rolling with the punch. And so by following the ego transcends itself. And in this moment of insight, the great Westerner, who comes out of a whole tradition of human personality which centers it upon the ego, upon individual separateness, by going along consistently with this principle, comes to the same position as the Easterner. That is to say, to the point of view where one sees conflict, which at first sight had seemed absolute, and resting upon a primordial unity, and thereby attaining a profound, unshakable peace of the heart, which can nevertheless contain conflict, not a peace that is simply static and lifeless, but a peace that passes understanding.
You've been listening to Alan Watts with a talk entitled...
Finishing off our lecture tribute to Carl Jung tonight on Alan Watts here on WFMU. And we'll be right back in a second with part two. Tonight's program is Seeing Through the Game, taking us until 7 o'clock and Joe Frank at that time. This is Freeform listener sponsor WFMU in Jersey City. Alan Watts, brought to you every Thursday night at 6. And you can write to us for more information, P.O. Box 2011, Jersey City, New Jersey 07303. Stay tuned.
I suppose that some of you have read very fascinating work that was written many years ago by C.P. Jung, a commentary that he wrote to a translation of a Chinese classic by Richard Wilhelm called The Secret of the Golden Flower. Now you may remember that in that commentary he takes up the very fascinating problem of the dangers inherent in the adoption of Oriental ways of life by Westerners, but more particularly the adoption of Oriental spiritual practices such as yoga. And I remember I learned a great deal from that essay and appreciated it very much in ever so many ways, because even in my own fascination with forms of Oriental philosophy, I've never been tempted to forget that I'm a Westerner. But as I think this essay over, I'm not sure that Jung discouraged the practice of yoga by Westerners for quite the right reasons. I find so often the difficulty in Jung's ideas lies in his theory of history, which is, I feel, a hangover from 19th century theories of history encouraged by Darwinism. Namely, that there's a sort of orderly progression from the ape through the primitive to the civilized man. And of course, naturally, at that time, that was all hitched in with the theory of progress. And it was highly convenient for the cultures of Western Europe, which were then one up on everybody else, to consider themselves in the van of progress. And when they visited the natives of Borneo and Australia and so on, to be able to feel that they were perfectly justified in appropriating their lands and dominating them, because they were giving them the benefits of the last word in evolution. And therefore, under the influence of that sort of theory of history, which is felt in the work of both Freud and Jung, one gets the feeling of there being a kind of progressive development of human consciousness. And Jung is charitable enough to assume that because the Chinese and Indian civilizations are immeasurably older than ours, they've had the possibility of far more sophistication in psychic development, even though he feels, and probably rightly, that there are things they can learn from us. But the reason why he discourages the Westerner from the practice of yoga is that he says this is a discipline for a far older culture than ours, which along certain lines has progressed much further and has learned certain things that we haven't mastered at all yet. And thus he points out that when somebody embraces Vedanta or Theosophy or any yoga school in the West and tries to master a discipline of concentration in which they have to oust from their consciousness all wandering thoughts. He says that this for a Westerner may be a very dangerous thing indeed, because just exactly what the Westerner may need to do is to allow free rein to his wandering thoughts and his imagination and his fantasy, because it's only in this way that he can get in touch with his unconscious, and that his unconscious will not leave him in peace until he gets in touch with it. And he assumes the members of Oriental cultures have done this long before they went in for yoga practice. Now, I don't think this is quite true. But I do think there are other reasons why Western people need to exercise a good deal of discrimination and caution in adopting Eastern disciplines and ways of life.
Okay, before he gets into that, let's see if we can nail down the premise here. Basically, they're saying that because of the massive difference in culture and the way that a Western psyche is developed from birth until adulthood, they're not well suited to deal with the trials presented to them mentally, psychologically speaking, when engaging in such a spiritual philosophy. I think that's the gist of it. which, in a rare turn for Carl Jung, seems a bit reductive, to be honest.
In other words, it's rather like the problem of taking medicine. You know, if you don't feel very well and you go to a friend's medicine cabinet and you sort of look it over and see bottles of medicine in there, and you say, I'm sick, I need medicine, so you take some medicine. Any medicine will do. Well, it won't. And according to what's the matter with you, so the medicine has to be prescribed. And I don't think that the things which some of the Eastern disciplines are designed to cure are quite the same things that we need.
Mm.
Now, it's fundamental to my view of the nature of such forms of discipline as Buddhism and Taoism that they are ways of liberation from a specific kind of confinement. That is to say, there are ways of liberation from what I've sometimes called the social hypnosis. In other words, every culture, every society, as a group of people in communication with each other, has certain rules of communication. And from culture to culture, these rules differ in just the same way that languages differ. And a culture can hold together on very, very different kinds of rules. I won't say any kinds of rules, but very different kinds of rules. Always provided that the members agree about them, whether they're forced to agree, whether they agree tacitly, or whatever the reason may be. And these rules are, in a way, very much like the rules of a game. In other words, take a game like chess. You can have the kind of chess we play with an 8-square board, or you can have a kind of chess that the Japanese play with a 9-square board. It doesn't make any difference so long as you both play on the same board and by the same rules. But since chess is a game, and in the same way, the development of human cultures is also, in a way, a game. That
absolutely.
Is to say, it's the elaborate...
Okay, so I would say life itself is actually a game of sorts. One with very high stakes that do matter. And, you know, kind of like one of my favorite terms for it is having blood in the game. It's a game where we have a lot of blood to the point that death exists. But it's a game nonetheless. And I think the building of the social construct is perhaps the biggest mini game within the game that exists. And perhaps one of the most important. Likely the most important.
Operation of a form of life. And the fun of it, in a way, is the fun of elaborating it in just some interesting form. That's the same as the fun of a game. The fun of a game is it has a certain interest. But it doesn't follow that the rules of the game correspond to the actual structure of human nature or to the laws of the universe. But because in every culture it's necessary to impress upon especially its younger members that these rules jolly well have to be kept, they are usually, in some way or other, connected with the laws of the universe and given some sort of divine sanction. And there are indeed cultures in which the senior members of the group realize that that's a hoax, that that's as if it's made up and is done to terrify the young, and when they become senior members of the culture themselves, they see through the thing, but they don't let on, they keep it quiet. They don't let out to those who are supposed to be impressed that this was really a hoax to get them to behave. Well, anyway.
Hold on, let's run that back.
sort of divine sanction. And that these rules jolly well have to be kept. They are usually, in some way or other, connected with the laws of the universe and given some sort of divine sanction. And there are indeed cultures in which the senior members of the group realize that that's a hoax, that that's as if it's a made up and is done to terrify the young. And when they become senior members of the culture themselves, they see through the thing, but they don't let on. They keep it quiet. They don't let out to those who are supposed to be impressed that this was really a hoax to get them to behave.
Well, okay, so I think basically what he's getting at here is that the absoluteness, the 99% correctness of any given societal structure is a lie, so that people will embrace it. And that I can kind of believe in. Or that I pretty much do subscribe to. I think, you know, I don't know, I don't want to throw any exact numbers out, but we are definitely not nearly as certain as we always claim to be. That's why society is always changing, structure always shifts. Because we actually can do better by many degrees. And slowly we do so. But for the time that is the best structure that we have, we must treat it like that is the best structure that we can have. Elsewise, anarchy spreads. People reject the structure. So fair enough there.
Anyway, after a great deal of careful study, I've come to the conclusion that the function of these ways of liberation is basically to make it possible for those who have the determination, and we'll see why in a while, to make it possible for those who have the determination to be free from the social hypnosis. In other words, if you were a member of the culture of India, at almost any time between maybe 900 BC and 1800 AD, it would be for you a matter of common sense about which everybody agreed that you were under the control of a process called karma. Not exactly a law of cause and effect, but a process of cosmic justice whereby every fortune that occurred to you would be the result of some action in the past that was good, and every misfortune that occurred to you would be the result of some action in the past that was evil. And furthermore, that this action in the past might not have been done in this present life, but in a former life. It was simply axiomatic to those people that they were involved in a long, long process of reincarnation, reaping the rewards and punishments. And there was not only the possibility of being reincarnated again in the human form, but if you were exceedingly good, you might be born in one of the heavens, the paradises, and if you were exceedingly bad, you might be born for an insufferable period of years, not forever, in a purgatory. And the purgatories of the Hindus and Buddhists are just as ingeniously horrible as those of the Christians. Well, of course, everybody knows, I mean, anybody seems to have any sense, that all this imagination of post-mortem courts of justice is a way of telling people, well, if the secular police don't catch you, the celestial police will catch you, and therefore you had better behave. And it's an ingenious device for encouraging ethical conduct.
Yeah, because people don't generally believe that their deeper, more subconscious self will punish them if nothing else does. They're like, no, I know who I am, and therefore I don't feel any type of way about it. I definitely am not a problem for myself in choosing to act morally. You generally have very little idea of actually who they are. They believe that their surface thoughts pretty much comprise the entirety of their being. And that is so far from the truth. In reality, it's only the surface. Dig a little bit deeper and you find a lot more. So much harder to convey that than it is, at least than it has been through most of human history, to simply say, well, the gods will smite you. Or God, singular, depending on where in history we're talking about. Either way, it makes a sense of a kind.
Now, but remember that for a person brought up in that climate of feeling where everybody believes this to be true, it seems a matter of sheer common sense that it's so. And it's very difficult for a person so brought up not to believe that that is the state of affairs. Take an equivalent situation in our own culture. It's still enormously difficult for most people to believe that space may not be Newtonian space, that is to say, a three-dimensional continuum which extends indefinitely forever. The idea of a four-dimensional curved space seems absolutely fantastic and can't even be conceived by people unversed in the mathematics of modern physics. Or again, as I've often pointed out, it's very difficult for us to believe that the forms of nature are not made of some stuff called matter. That's a very unnecessary idea from a strictly scientific point of view, but it's awfully difficult for us to believe it. To believe, in other words, that there isn't this underlying stuff. And not so long ago, it was practically impossible for people to conceive that the planets did not revolve about the Earth encased in crystalline spheres. And it took a very considerable shaking of the imagination when astronomers began to point out that this need not necessarily be so. All right, so now let's go back to the problem of somebody living in the culture of ancient India. Here it is, as a matter of common sense, you see, that he is going to be reborn. Now, there's some perhaps exceedingly intelligent person who, for one reason or another, discovers that this idea is not so. After all, when you get such disciplines as Vedanta and Buddhism, they say that the ultimate goal of the discipline is release from the rounds of rebirth, and incidentally also, which is fundamental to it, release from the illusion that you are a separate individual confined to this body. But so far as both of these things are concerned, they also say that the person who is liberated from the round of rebirth, as well as from the illusion of being an ego, sees, when he is liberated, that the process of rebirth and the whole cosmology of reincarnation and karma, as well as the individual ego, are in a way illusions. That is to say...
Okay, I'm going to come back to this. I'll be right back in like just a couple minutes. I have a lot to say on his take on karma. I think this is one of the areas. I think this is pretty much the area where Alan Watts deviates hard from his own beliefs, in a sense. He takes a lot of his beliefs from yoga. I think the yogic idea of karma is more correct than it is wrong. So it's not 100%. He thinks it's more wrong than correct. I'll come back to this. All right, what do we got going on here? I'm gonna wait to address the karma thing after this boss battle. So,
you servers!
I'm gonna do this in quiet, I guess.
Is mine!
Oh crap! You get it, boys. That could be a pretty easy win. It's gotten cold in here. Did not have this quest, I don't think. Oh wait, okay, hold on. Alright, I got the blueprints, hell yeah! Oh, whoop! That's EXP for me. EXP for me. I think the item for it was good too. Priest is out of here, I guess, but we should be alright without him. We just gotta get back to the front room for the ring quest. Should get me pretty close to 33. A little bit of grinding and Deathless. Maybe I shall just port Undercity. Hit a Wrathy and see if I can't fucking get a little bit of AoE grinding in. Shit, maybe I'll even just be able to get a Scarlet Monastery run down. That'd be dope. I gotta do something about this cold though. Alright, I'm gonna follow him and go get freaking hoodie.
Thank you.
Okay. While we're on this run, let's talk about the karma thing, right? So, it stands to that karma just part of the illusion. Same way that Maya, the great illusion, is the material world. And this comes from a denial of his idea of an afterlife or birth, of death and rebirth. Basically to him, you know, God being the singular consciousness that manifests itself in any possible incarnation that exists, basically all forms of life and even non-life, all matter in the world, I mean, it does matter, he is God. So he kind of subscribes to that, but kind of looks at it as, once you die, you return to that oneness in its entirety, and there's no longer any separation, and therefore, there's no you to know that you are anything. The soul, the ego, is gone. But I think the Christians, in one example, kind of got it right. And the separation between soul, spirit, and body. So there's that third aspect of spirit. I think the soul does die. The mind, the ego, it's over with. And the spirit continues on. And the spirit collects karma from one life to the next. And I think this is how that individual karma that gets built up isn't just a now universal debt. It still is localized to a singular spirit. There's a lot of reasons why I think this makes sense, but this is kind of the gist of like why I think the karma thing isn't as much of a psychological illusion as Alan Watts looks at it to be. I think there's a little bit more depth to the situation. I think because Alan Watts has had such a good track record with distilling things into relatively simplified understandings, it's kind of led him to a reductionist mind state. He tends to think things are just generally simple and not that complex. That's kind of what leads him to this take that he has. But I'll let him continue.
Say he sees that they are Maya, and I would like to translate Maya at this moment, not so much an illusion, as a playful construct, a social institution. So he sees, you see, that those things are not so. They are only pretended to be so. And you see, he ceases to believe in karma and reincarnation and all that in exactly the same way that a modern agnostic no longer believes in the resurrection of the body at the Day of Judgment. I know this to be so because although you will get very many Hindus and Buddhists who say that they believe in reincarnation and come over here and teach it as part of the doctrine of Vedanta or Buddhism, the most sophisticated and the most profound, I'll say perhaps profound rather than sophisticated, Buddhists that I have known have said that they don't believe in it literally at all. And so I could say that those who do believe in it simply because it's part of their past. And they've not yet been able to be liberated from it. So it seems to me very funny indeed when Western people who become interested in Vedanta or Buddhism, that is to say, in forms of discipline to liberate Hindus and Chinese people from certain social institutions. Western people adopt it, and then also adopt the ideas of reincarnation and karma from which these systems were designed to liberate them. Of course, they adopt them because they feel it's consoling that one will go on living, and that wasn't the point at all. Or that it explains something, that why one suffered in this life was not because the universe was unjust, but because you committed some misdeed in the past. And so...
So he takes another stance here to say that he basically posits that the world is unjust. Any belief to the contrary is simply naivete. At least that's what I gather from it. Again, I'd have to disagree. I don't think that karma does partially explain... Karma does partially explain the reasons why people do experience certain perceivedly unearned justices. I think a lot of it is also spent to people just don't understand their impact. And there's a lot that just has been earned in this life. They don't understand why. And I also think that there's the universal karma of mankind accrued from dissension from God and coming into mortal form, which was necessary, but is still a... inherently a sin. So these things constitute the injustices that we face. Rather than just living in a world in which suffering can be arbitrarily obtained. Also, suffering isn't just an act of maliciousness from the universe, but is a heavy-handed but still loving, ultimately, tool. It's another thing where I think Christians kind of border on getting it right. Did I get an item out of that? I'm gonna have to go through this in a minute. Everybody here is a member of my clan. Guild, whatever. At least the Warcraft 3 usage of clan over guild. I don't know why. Played a lot of World of Warcraft. Should be used to guild over clan by now. Still say clan all the time. Well, let me get back to his thing.
Westerners who take up the Oriental doctrines in that spirit, unfortunately, take up the very illusions from which these doctrines were supposed to be ways of deliverance. Now, that may be difficult to see just because so many practicing Hindus and Buddhists say they believe in reincarnation and this whole process of the cycles of karma and so on. And they, after all, are practicing it and they should know. Well, now look here, there's a certain good reason why they shouldn't. Of course, I'm making an exception of the Indian or Chinese who's been educated in Western style. And he ceases to believe, maybe, in the cosmologies of his own culture, But he's not liberated in the Buddhist sense, because in receiving a Western education, he's become a victim of our social institutions instead. I mean, he's just exchanged, as it were, one trouble for another. But when you take the situation as it stands, or as it did stand in India, isolated from Western culture, obviously, no society can tolerate within its own borders the existence of a way of liberation, a way of seeing through its institutions, without feeling that such a way constitutes a threat to law and order. Anybody who sees through the institutions of society and sees them for, as it were, creative fictions, in the same way as a novel or a work of art is a creative fiction, anybody who sees that, of course, could be regarded by the society as a potential menace. But then you may ask, well, if Buddhism and Vedanta and so on were indeed ways of liberation, how could Indian or Chinese society or Burmese society have tolerated their presence? Well, the answer lies simply in the much misunderstood esotericism of these disciplines. In other words, that those who taught them, the masters of these disciplines, made it incredibly difficult for uninitiated people to get in on the inside. And their method of initiating them, in a way, was to put them through trap after trap after trap to see if they could find their way through. In other words, such a master would not dream of beginning by disabusing the neophyte and saying, well, you know, all these things you heard from your father and mother and teachers and so on were fairy tales. Oh, no, indeed. He would do what is called in Buddhism exercise the use of upaya, the Sanskrit word meaning skillful devices or skillful means, sometimes described as giving a child a yellow leaf to stop it crying for gold. After all, when you approach one of these ways of liberation from the outside, it looks like something very, very fantastic. Here you are literally going to be released from a literally true and physical cycle of endless incarnations in heavens and hells and all kinds of states. And therefore, naturally, to do that, what an undertaking that must be. What a wonderful, extraordinary person you've got to become. And so the neophyte is ready for almost anything. And the teacher, because the fundamental problem in this whole thing is for him to get rid of the illusion, you see, that he's a separate ego. If there's no separate ego or sort of soul, then there's nothing to be reincarnated. So all the teacher really, he has all kinds of complicated ways of doing it, but all that he really says to him is, well now, if you will look deeply into your ego, you will find out that it is a non-ego, that your self is the universal self, as he might say if he were a Vedantist. Or if he were a Buddhist, he might say, if you look for your ego, you won't find it. So look for it and see and really go into it. And so he gets the man meditating and trying by his ego to get rid of his ego. Well, that is a beautiful trap. It can last forever until one sees through it. In other words, this is like trying to sweep the darkness out of a room with a broom. Or it's worse than that. Zhuangzi had a nice figure for it, beating a drum in search of a fugitive. That's to say, you know, when the police go out because they've had a telephone call that there's a burglar, they come racing to the house with a siren full blast, and the burglar hears it and runs away. Because, of course, to try and get rid of the ego for one's advantage in some ways is an egotistic enterprise, and you can't do it. And so, of course, the student gets to the point where he begins to realize that everything he does to get rid of his ego is egotistic. And this is the kind of trap in which the teacher gets him, until, of course, he comes to the point of seeing that his supposed division from himself into, say, I and me, the controller, controlling part of me and the controlled part of me, the knower and the known and all that, is phony. There is no way of standing aside from yourself, in other words, and, as it were, changing yourself in that way. But he discovers this finally. At the same time, he discovers, almost at the last minute, you might say, the fallacy, or rather the fantasy nature, the game-like nature of the system of cosmology which has existed to, as it were, underpin or give the basic form of the social institutions of his particular culture or society. In other words, you may put it in another way. One of the basic things which all social rules of convention conceal is what I would call the fundamental fellowship between yes and no. Say, in the Chinese symbolism of the positive and the negative, the yang and the yin. You know, you've seen that symbol of them together like two interlocked fishes. Well, the great game, I mean, the whole...
Because life is not either prickles or goo. It's gooey prickles and prickly goo.
Up fish and down.
They go together, like back and front, male and female.
And there's out for a
king. And that's the answer to philosophy.
White fish is one of these...
See, I'm a philosopher.
Black fish.
And I'm not going to...
Ah, that audio. They won't ever talk to each other. Do not like it. Very much downvoting on that. Video person, though. I think we'll drop it there. He does make a point here, though, of how teachers of enlightenment try to get you to do the impossible so that you can realize that it's impossible, in a sense. And here's another way of putting it. He says, any teacher of enlightenment, it's just putting you through paces in order to get you to come off it. By come off it, he means to just let go, basically. Enlightenment is being at peace, and that is the point, is to be at peace. And there's no trick to it. The trick to it is that there is no trick to it. Like I was saying earlier, all wisdom is paradoxical. I feel like this must be one of his earlier talks, because he gives it less credit here than he normally does. Rather than going into the beauty of that trick, he puts it in words that kind of write it off as something that is unneeded. But there is no other way for most people to get it. There are exceptions. There's exceptions to every rule. Some people just suddenly become enlightened out of nowhere. It happens. That's by far the exception and not the norm. For the vast majority of people who seek enlightenment, they're going to have to play the game. They're going to have to try to defeat your ego with your ego before you can realize that it's not going to work. in not just a logical sense, but in like a deep knowing sense and a feel it emotionally sense. Like, Alan Watts' biggest struggle in life, R.I.P., great man, but I feel like his biggest struggle in life was in reconciling the beauty of life and the higher aspects of its nature with his very practical, clinical, exacting ego that really chose to take things in the most literal and reductionary sense. That caused him to miss out, I think, a bit. Great teacher. Got a lot more, understood a lot more than I think most people ever do. But was still a flawed human being. Very much, though, do enjoy listening to many of his talks. He has a way with words, especially his later ones. So I feel like this one's probably more of an earlier one. It's kind of hard to determine just by looking at videos. You know, when these talks occurred. They often don't put any dates on them. Oh, here we go. This one was in 1938. Yeah, he died in like the late 60s, early 70s. So this was definitely an earlier work. The video footage, another thing that makes it hard to judge. Like, so if you just look at the video footage, oftentimes it's not even... The video footage has nothing to do with the audio. They're not from the same source. So that keeps it from being able to tell as well. Kind of have to do a little bit of digging most of the time. But yeah, regardless. Super interesting way of putting things. Very insightful most of the time. Very much enjoy. Now, I think I'm about to try to put together a Scarlet Monastery run. Ugh! But seeing how I don't think I have any viewers right now, I need a bit of not necessarily that I need a break. I just need to be able to be quiet without feel like I'm not doing my job. So I'm gonna go to like a BRB for like 10, 15 minutes so I can sort some things out. Not have anything playing. Focus on what I'm drawing real quick. And then I'll get back to it. Cool. Cool. All right, and we're back. We just need to see if we're going to be able to pull off. Excellent. Need to see if we're going to be able to pull off our little bit of AoE grind here that we'd like to do. I give ourselves like a 50-50 on this one. Really like it to go well. I'm absolutely not holding my breath. If it does not go well, we'll just head back to Dustless. Well, probably port straight to Org. Or maybe we can turn in that quest. And then go to Dustless. Either way, we'll do our quest in Dustless. That'll definitely get us to 33. Sure. And then I think we can probably go 34. Well, we get a good ways to 34. And string with the word veil. And then, really, hopefully by then, they can just go ahead and do Scarlet Monastery and run like a bunch of back-to-back Scarlet Monastery runs. We'll gear it up that way, do something interesting, get to play with other people, and we can get, like, to 38 in Scarlet Monastery. Who's that? Do I know who that is? Frostmoot? I don't know Frostmoot. Let's get this grind, baby, grind, baby, grind. I believe we only got two mobs. We're gonna have to fight for this, clearly. I think we got those new bandages. A lot. While we're doing that, let's see if we can find ourselves a good follow up video. No, actually, maybe we'll just kick the music back up, you know? We could just chill, you know? Chill and talk a bit. Wish I had a chat. Ask you guys about topics. It's hard to come up with stuff talk up off the top of your head. I gotta stay soft. The crap is. Hopefully catch anybody that does decide to drop by. But it's hard to sit up, figure out what to say. Dude, I'm not doing a group with you, okay? I'm here to AoE grind. You're just gonna take you're gonna make it meaningless for me to do so. I got himself four. Four is like the minimum number you want for it to be worth it. I really thought we'd get a spawn on like this side over here, at least by now. I'm wasting my time otherwise. Jeez. Kinda wanna go over there and see if I can grab like those three mobs. I know that one guy, I get four actually. One guy's not gonna pull. Alright, let's try it, let's try it. That was a waste of the cooldown. What a misclick way to start things off. Oh my gosh. Freaking fence screwed me. Appreciate it, guy. Bother to freaking fight him for when he's over there being so generous to me when I messed up that pool so badly. We can get this next spawning group, I think. Just those two to spawn, though. Where's the rest of you? Three at least. Three's not a bad number. Not ideal. But it's not bad. Fourth guy to come, so it's actually worked out for us. Enough mana left whatever to deal with him too. Nice. Vibey ass music. more Harris Heller, of course. Okay.
Nope.
I did not want to pull him right away. I think they're a little too close. I might end up having to pull back a bit. I think we got that actually nicely. Yeah, we got it. We nailed that one. Heroes to the air. One guy also survived with a sliver of health. We will just wand him down. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. This is a great way to collect a lot of silk, which will be nice getting past this last little hump for our first aid. Of course, we need to hit level 35 before we can start the quest. Oh shit. I misclicked on a blink when I meant to help him out with a root. Oopsie daisy. Got him another 4. Nice. Oh, he's gonna get all of them, huh? Shit, dude. Good shit. Oh. I fucked you up. Tried to help him and we almost fucked our guy. Alright, let's see if we can grab these guys. I want this one too. Oh my god, you bitch. This is not gonna work out. Fail. Try this again. Yeah. Ah, shit. I messed that up. Maybe if I had dropped a health potion, I would have been okay, but... I didn't do that. Trying to grab that freaking straggle in the end there just was just too much, I guess. Bride is level 43. Oh, how the hell? Let me guess. Somebody already got all the ones I was trying to get. Dude, I am no good at this, man. I gotta improve. There's this bitch about to fuck with me. Freaking bitches. Can I freaking heal up in peace now? Jeebus. Get some battle belt. You got him! This is a good pull. Hell yeah, the metal music fucking got us going, baby, let's go! Slipping my bonds ain't fucking me up. Luckily our cold snap came back off cooldown. Can't believe these guys are still resisting me so much. I thought I'm out leveling them at this point. I understood it earlier when they were like a level above me, but Jesus, man. What's the reason now, so that Orange Jesus hates me? I think we can go inside this building and get a pull out of it. Let's see if it's doable. Nope, there's nothing in here. Dang. I just did the pull without battery. Oh my god, the freaking fence fucked me. Alright, never mind. Just disengage. Just don't even try now. Oh my god! Jesus! Ah! I actually pulled a half decent amount of experience out of this already, but jeez, man, the freaking deaths are killing me, man. The deaths are killing me. And then, you know, see, now that guy's got the pull, man. Huh. Yep, this is it. I'm fucked. My freaking shit about to break.
Spell isn't ready yet.
Oh my god, the freaking patrols! This bitch is gonna die. This bitch is gonna die. We're gonna get this. We're gonna get this. We're gonna get this. You fucking move. If that guy takes my shit, I swear. That guy takes my shit, I swear. No, you asshole. He's getting them. Oh my god, dude. What the fuck? Dude, suck a dick, dude. Give me something, dude. Fuck! Can we scoop up his loss? Where he's so scooped up so many of mine. I think we got this. Thankfully, Jesus. That was 3, 4, 5. 5's not bad. And we can still loot these other ones from earlier. We pulled together this pool. Bit of an odd one, but we got it. Marcel Dabber is about to be a problem. Oh my god. They came out of the woodworks for me this time. That was something. No. Oh no, I fucked up. Can we have a recovery option? Three is really not that worth it, but we took what we could get. I got like five just now, unfortunately. Maybe a little more patience would have been better. Oh well. It is what it is. Play some Metallica. That's asking for trouble, though. We got these suckers. Got a stack of soap cloth already. I realized that was a quest item. Holy crap. Level 36 plus, we get a turn in. Well. Don't need Kanata's head. More about that later, though. He has to get a crit right about now. Take it. Well, hell. Hell's bells, no shells. Got going on. Boom, 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 boom. Got something out of that. Talent and coming level 38 Night Elf.
That's the only
fuck killed me. Alright, Elias is gonna camp. It might be time to leave. But I've gotten all we can get out of this. All right, let's get out of here. Poor Org. Maybe not. Maybe we can still get something to happen. The ice block was not the right move, guy. You should have kept trying to run. Pop the heal potion if you had it. I really don't want to leave. Oh, without that other head. Look at Alliance. Fucking grubbing for honor. Yeah, they shut this place down. I'm on a 2-minute cooldown. Jeez, man, that sucks. That sucks. It be what it be, though. I think with that, we're probably in stream for lunch. And I'll be back a bit later. Bye for now, everybody.